Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. I'm very glad to see so many new faces as well, and as well as the old friendly ones. Welcome at the Danube Institute. Unfortunately, Thomas Sullivan, president of the Institute, cannot be here today. He regrets very much not being with us. He's had a surgery and he's recuperating at home. He's doing fine, but he needs some rest. He's sending his greetings to all of you, and he'll be back in December or January. First of all, I'd like to welcome, my name is Noemi Korani. I'm the executive director of the Danube Institute, and I try to live up to the standards John has set in moderating the discussion. It won't be very easy. I'd like to introduce our guests first. First and foremost, Ambassador José Ángel López Florin, Ambassador of Spain to Hungary. It's an honor for us to have you here. I don't know whether I might reveal it, but this is the first time that he talks on this issue in public, in such a circle. Mr. Sándor Villanod is a senior researcher at the Institute of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and an expert on Catalonia as well, I think. If you have heard anything about Catalonia recently, either on TV or on radio, it's a safe bet that it was probably Sándor talking. And he's also an expert on Spain and Latin American countries, both the political and the economic situation. And Zoltán Kantor is the director of the Nemzetpolitikai Kutatóintézet, which is the Institute on Hungarian Minorities Abroad, Research Institute on Hungarian. No, Research Institute for Hungarian Communities Abroad. I will introduce them in more detail when they take the floor. We are very glad to welcome you here. It's a very gray and cold day, and we'll sail to warmer climates and talk about Catalonia. Welcome. Very nice to see so many ambassadors here, it's an honor. So we will not only talk about Catalonia, but also about autonomy in a wider context, as you've also already seen in the title. The issue of autonomy has always been very important for Hungarians, but also for the government, but especially for the ethnic Hungarians living beyond our borders. And they have made a lot of effort trying to put this on the agenda, on the international agenda, with limited success, I have to say. Now the events in Catalonia have propelled this issue in the forefront of international attention. Whether this is good or bad for the minority groups beyond our borders is questionable, but it at least offers us an opportunity to talk about the issue. Catalonia, along with South Tyrol and Åland and some other regions, have always been a model, or rather a daydream, for Hungarian minority groups beyond the border, and a model autonomy. And now the recent events in Catalonia may not mean promotion of the issue of autonomy, but rather a setback, probably, but we'll have to decide that during the discussion. And we'd like to explore this whole issue with our guests. We have to explore what and why, what happened in Catalonia and why it has happened. The ambassador of Spain will talk about the events first, and later on you are welcome to ask him questions. I hope that our other speakers will always react to his take. Ambassador López Florin is one of the most active and most popular ambassadors in Budapest. I can attest to that. He has been here since 2014. Before that, he was ambassador in Bosnia and Herzegovina, Bulgaria and Slovakia as well. So he has a very deep knowledge about our region. I'd like you to talk to us about the events and about what to expect on December 21st. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very, very much to the Danube Institute, and thank you to Naomi for Joe so gallantly hosting this event. It is true that a year ago I was asked by the Foreign Affairs Institute to speak about this subject, and I said no. I didn't think at that time it was the proper moment. But right now I think it is the proper moment, exactly, and that is what I am going to try to talk about. My intention in this sort of meetings is not to read texts, but I'm going to read one, because what I am going to read is a fact sheet. And it is important to know what has happened and why we are here. After that, I promise, we will have a very open and lively discussion as far as I am concerned. Nationalism, sorry, also one last question. I was allowed 10 minutes. Probably it will take longer. I hope it will take not much longer, but I need to say certain things. Nationalism is not a new movement in Spain. It is part of the country's history and part of the history of similar countries. In recent years, the pro-independence movement has become more pervasive in our country, above all in Catalonia, during the worst economic crisis in modern history. A crisis that resulted in substantial cuts to public spending and affected many people in Spain. Over the past days, we have witnessed an attempt to bring about the culmination of an illegal process of independence in Catalonia, during which separatists, citing their supposed representation of all the people of Catalonia and disregarding the wishes of the majority of Catalan society, have violated the Spanish Constitution and the Statute of Autonomy of Catalonia, which guarantees its self-rule. They have repeatedly disobeyed the rulings handed down by Spain's Constitutional Court. They have infringed the rights and freedoms of the citizenry. They have acted in an authoritarian and undemocratic manner. And they have used the institutions of their self-government for the benefit of an illegal cause. These actions have forced the government of Spain, with the support of the parties that uphold the Spanish Constitution, to active the mechanism of the the mechanism to control the autonomous communities provided for in Article 155 of the Constitution, a provision which is similar to those found in the constitution of over decentralized country lies, I suppose. Take it as an executive summary. The detail comes now. The latest origins of the situation can be found in the severe economic crisis that Spain has suffered in recent years. The recession, which made it necessary to take tough steps to rein in spending, has been exploited by the secessionists in Catalonia to falsely blame the rest of Spain for supposed economic and political abuse. In fact, in September 2012, the then president of the government of Catalonia, Mr. Artur Mas, demanded a fiscal arrangement from Mariano Rajoy, president of the government of Spain, well aware that it was financially unfeasible. President of the government Rajoy undertook to improve financing for Catalonia once central government finances had been consolidated. But Mr. Mas rejected this offer and let his government drift into separatism, culminating in the events of the recent weeks. It is important to note that since the aforementioned discussions, two regional elections have been held in Catalonia, as a result of which the party that has governed Catalonia for the longest period since the return of democracy in 1978, that is, Convergencia, now known as PDeCAT, has received fewer and fewer votes, forcing it to turn to support to the support of increasingly radical partners. Firstly, an openly pro-independence party, Esquerra Republicana de Catalunya, and since 2016, an anti-establishment, anti-capitalist, and Eurosceptic party, Candidatura d'Unitat Popular, thereon I will call it CUP, CUP, in conjunction with which it now governs. All of this support has been provided on the condition that a roadmap be drafted, culminating in the independence of Catalonia. Over the past few years, the regional government has therefore ignored the real problems that the people of Catalonia are facing. All of its actions have been focused solely on advancing an illegal secessionist process. The outcome of this undemocratic process was decided from the very beginning, despite attempts to disguise this with ballot boxes and pass it off as a democratic process. The regional government has therefore led the people of Catalonia under false pretenses. They have lied about the lawfulness of the process. They have concealed the economic and political risks, which are now clear, not to mention the immediate expulsion from the EU that would result from secession. And they have claimed to have international support, which they do not. Through this manipulation, they have pitted Catalans against each other, creating deep divisions in society. They have also attempted to mislead international public opinion and the media, passing themselves off as a peaceful and democratic movement. They have portrayed Catalonia as an oppressed society in which the vast majority of people long for independence. They have disparaged the state of democracy in Spain, and they have pretended to be willing to talk, when in fact they have chosen the only discussed matters that cannot be negotiated by the Spanish government. First the referendum and then the independence. The Catalan government was perfectly aware that this process was illegal and undemocratic, not only because of the repeated warnings from Spain's constitutional court, from other political parties, and from civil society, but also because they acknowledge this in their own reports and have been warned on numerous occasions by their legal advisors. They were also warned of the exodus of companies and capital flight that this uncertainty would cause, and the undesirable impact of the economy and on employment. Furthermore, time after time, the major EU institution and world leaders have advised them that if Catalonia were to split from Spain, it would not be a member of the European Union and would not be recognized internationally. However, they have preferred to maintain the roadmap, putting their political interest before the interest of their people. Spain is a consolidated democracy, governed by the rule of law, which defends the citizens' rights and freedoms with every guarantee. The Spanish Constitution of 1978 establishes separation of powers, rule of law, and legal certainty, and it prohibits arbitrary action from public authorities. It must be recalled that Spain's 1978 constitution enshrines in Articles 1 and 2 the principles of national sovereignty, which resides in the Spanish people as a whole, and of unity, similar to the fundamental norms of advanced democracies. The purported exercise of the right to self-determination by part of the territory is not permitted by the Spanish constitution, nor is it permitted by any constitution of countries similar to ours. This has been stated again and again by the Constitutional Court in its judgments and by Spain's National Parliament, which in April 2014 presented with a petition from the regional governments to allow it assume the power to hold a referendum of self-determination. This was rejected for legal reasons with the support of more than 85% of the members of the national parliaments, including more than half of the members of Catalonia that were sitting in the national parliament. This was not an obstacle to the fact that in November 2014, and in spite of warnings from and prohibitions by the Constitutional Court, the regional government called a purported referendum that was illegal, lacking any possible democratic guarantee, and in which 2 out of 3 Catalans called to participate avoided doing so. Therefore, then Catalan President Mas and another 3 members of his government were tried for a criminal offense of contempt of court and banned from holding public office. In the wake of this drift towards secession, in September 2015 elections were held once again in Catalonia, which were intended to be interpreted as a plebiscite. It was intended as such by the regional government. In these elections, less than half of the Catalans, 47.7%, voted for political parties that proposed independence in the platforms. CUP, that is the totally anti-system party, gave parliamentary support to the new regional government in exchange, and this is crucial, for imposing a new regional president, Mr. Carles Puigdemont, as well as a roadmap to accelerate steps towards secession, which actions aimed at defying democratic institutions and deceiving the public in Catalonia. During this process, there have been many calls for dialogue and caution on the part of the President of the Government of Spain, Mr. Mariano Rajoy. The fact there has been constant contact and collaboration with the regional government to address the needs of Catalan. It is worth noting that Spain is a highly decentralized country and the degree of self-government that Catalonia enjoys is wide-ranging, similar to that of a federal state. However, there are many areas in which there is extensive cooperation and support, such as investment in infrastructure, with the Spanish state assuming most of Catalonia's social spending, unemployment benefits and pensions, and providing financial assistance. In fact, the government of Spain has provided liquidity for Catalonia to the tune of nearly 70 billion euros since 2012. I have converted that into Hungarian forints, 21 trillion forints that have been spent on Catalonia, as the region has not had access to the markets since 2010. And this has enabled Catalonia to make debt payments and keep its social services running. Nevertheless, Mr. Puigdemont always responded with blackmail to the latest appeals for dialogue and a return to the constitutional framework. And at all times, he has limited his supposed willingness to engage in a dialogue to a single issue, that of holding a referendum that he knows has no place within the Spanish constitutional framework, and which therefore cannot be negotiated by the president of the government of Spain, nor by any other president of the government of Spain. Despite all this, on 6th and 7th of September, the regional parliament of Catalonia approved two acts, the Self-Determination Referendum Act and the Act on Legal Transition and the Founding of the Republic of Catalonia, which openly contravene the Spanish Constitution and Catalonia's Statute of Autonomy. Both of these acts, which were kept hidden from the opposition, kept hidden from the opposition parties until the very day of their approval, were approved in an open violation of the regional parliament's rules of procedure and against the advice of its advisory bodies. But based on these acts, the government of Catalonia called a referendum on self-determination for 1st October and launched a series of actions to hold it. Both the acts of the Catalan regional parliament and the decree calling the referendum were suspended by Spain's constitutional court, which also handed down a unanimous decision on the referendum act, declaring it unconstitutional. In its judgment, the court notes that any attempt aimed at the partial or total disruption of the national unity and the territorial integrity of a country is incompatible with the purposes and principles of the Charter of the United Nations, and makes clear that the Catalan Parliament has operated entirely outside the law, has undertaken patently unlawful acts, has openly abandoned its constitutional and statutory duties, and has created a situation of utmost danger to the guarantees and rights set forth in the Spanish Constitution and the Statute of Autonomy of Catalonia, for all of the people in Catalonia. The court also states that as a result, there have been very serious violations of the legislative procedures, which undoubtedly affected the expression of the will of the Catalan Parliament, the rights of the parliamentary minorities, and the rights of all citizens to participate in public affairs through representatives. Since then, the judiciary and the public prosecution service took action with the support of the police forces in their capacity as judicial police, not as a government police, as judicial police, in order to prevent the holding of an illegal consultation and to restore legality. To this end, different actions, searches and seizures of material were carried out, always with scrupulous respect for the procedures and the legally mandated rights and freedoms, bound by the obligation to uphold the law. Likewise, they acted on 1st October with the sole purpose of preventing the holding of a consultation proportionally and cautiously, acting in their defense, against those who, in an organized manner, sought to obstruct the actions ordered by the courts. The supposed 1st October vote had no validity whatsoever. The results are entirely invalid, both because the consultation was illegal and because there was an absolute lack of democratic guarantees. Thus, there was no independent electoral administration, nor any kind of electoral roll, which made it possible to vote more than once. The polling stations were made up of volunteers who supported independence. The institutions supposedly in charge of ensuring the neutrality of the process and counting the votes were kept secret, which precluded any attempt at impartiality. Even the supposed international observers who attended at the request of the pro-independence parties declared that the process lacked any guarantees. It must be recalled that both on 1st October and on the days before, the pro-independence associations assembly, Assemblea Nacional Catalana, ANC, and Òmnium Cultural organized protests to prevent the course of justice and to harass the police forces carrying it out. For these actions, on 20 and 21st September, and not for their ideas, the courts ordered the leaders of the two associations be held in custody, pending trial, accused of serious offense of sedition. The secessionist actions have been marked by provocation, poisoning and manipulating public opinion. Thus, following the events of 1st October, these groups spread on social media fake images of the police forces' action, and as proof of supposed police violence, which were echoed by many media outlets. Since then, some of these media have published retractions. This unrelenting manipulation and pressure on journalists has been condemned by Reporters Without Borders, which has accused the Generalitat, that is the government of Catalonia, press officers of crossing several red lines in their attempt to impose their own narrative. The pro-independence, the pro-independence groups disregard for the political plurality of any democracy was made patent by the closure of the Catalan parliament since 7th of September, with no ordinary activity, preventing the opposition from having any possibility of monitoring the work of the government, the Catalan executive. The only activity that has taken place since that day was the session of 1st October, when Catalan President Puigdemont, aware of the illegality of this entire process and the authoritarianism of his conduct, and ignoring the calls by the central government to restore the rule of law, appeared before the Catalan regional legislature and affirmed, quote, "I assume by presenting the results of the referendum before the parliament and before our fellow citizens, the mandate of Catalonia to become an independent state in the form of a republic," unquote. A few seconds later, he proposed on his own behalf and on behalf of his government that the parliament suspend the effects of the Declaration of Independence, declaration that had been pronounced, so that in forthcoming weeks we may engage in dialogue without which it is not possible to reach an agreed solution. To generate even more confusion afterwards, President Puigdemont signed, together with the other 71 parliamentarians from the parties that were along with him, a document entitled Declaration of the Representatives of Catalonia. In the document, they presented themselves as democratic representatives of the people of Catalonia, even though they won less than half of the vote in the latest elections. Constituted the Catalan Republic, they said so in this document, they constituted the Catalan Republic as an independent and sovereign state, ordered the entry of into force of the Act of Legal Transition and the founding of the Republic, which had been suspended by the Spain's Constitutional Court, announced to the international community and the authorities of the European Union the constitution of the Catalan Republic, and called upon states and international organizations to recognize the Catalan Republic as an independent and sovereign state. This action sought to confuse international public opinion with the aim of achieving, under the guise of openness to dialogue, international mediation between Spanish state and one of its regions, which is not applicable under international law and has been widely rejected. This entire process has caused great uncertainty and concern among the business community, which requires stability and legal certainty. In less than 10 days, more than 600 companies had moved the registered offices out of Catalonia. By now, as of today, more than 2,750 companies, half of them big, big companies, have moved out of Catalonia to other regions in Spain. It has also caused enormous distress in Catalan society, which broke its silence on 8 October with a historic demonstration in Barcelona, with more than 1 million people wrapped in flags of Spain and the constitutional flag of Catalonia, vindicating the Spanishness of Catalonia and calling for Catalan leaders and their institutions to return to common sense. This was the best proof that secessionists had not the majority, that Catalan society is plural, and that it wishes to coexist peacefully in Spain, the historic and prosperous nation to which Catalonia has peacefully. Two more paragraphs, and I will let the floor to my colleagues. Finally, faced with the persistence of this anti-democratic government momentum, on 11 October, President of Government Rajoy sent a formal request to Mr. Puigdemont asking him to clarify whether independence had been declared, and as set forth in Article 155 of the Spanish Constitution, to restore constitutional order. In light of President Puigdemont's refusal to comply with said formal request, despite two opportunities to do so, the government of Spain announced, with the support of the other parties that uphold the constitution, its decision to move forward with the procedure set forth in Article 155 of the constitution in order to adopt the appropriate and necessary measures to reinstate the rule of law and constitutional order, restore social harmony, and stop the damage being done to Catalonia. On the 27th of September, the Parliament of Catalonia approved a unilateral declaration of independence. And the day after, the Spanish government convoked the Spanish Senate, which, by an overwhelming majority, more than 80%, authorized the application of Article 155. 4 hours later, 24 hours later, the Spanish government suspended the Catalan autonomy, dissolved the regional government, and called for regional elections for the next 21st of December. There is a lot of more things to say, but it will take me very, very long. This is just a fact sheet. And I don't ask you to take it face value. But this can be consulted in all media everywhere. The rest is propaganda. Thank you, Leo.
Thank you. You've read it, but you've read it very expressively, so we appreciate it. And it's been also very, very interesting. And you have provided a very extensive basis for our further discussion. I'd like to give the floor now to Mr. Chandor Dulanaj, who is, as I already mentioned, a senior researcher at the Institute on Foreign Affairs and Trade, as well as a lecturer at Corvinus University, where he earned his PhD as well, habilitation, and he's an expert on Spain and Latin America and integration issues. We have seen or heard from the ambassador's intervention. We've heard about the economic loss that Catalonia has already had to face, the capital flight, so many companies fleeing. It may have also played a role, the secessionist movement may have also played a role in Barcelona not getting the EMA, the European Medicines Agency. I'm not sure, maybe Shanna will talk about this. So it's a pleasure for me to give the floor to Shanna.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. I don't know really where to start. The thoughts that I would like to share, or start reflecting on Mr. Ambassador's some of the points he was mentioning, but I think I will mix the two. I was asked to speak about the international political and economic and financial effects on the independization, obviously in perspective of Catalonia. I start with this. When I was writing some analysis about it, unfortunately for some of you, just in Hungarian, is available at the homepage of my institute, I was speaking about three scenarios. One scenario was the so-called very optimistic scenario, which was the scenario of the independence movement, which is called the first year of my university for the economic student, ceteris paribus scenario, which means that we don't change anything in the equation, just one thing. And they were thinking that the only proxy what they would change is switch from region of Spain to independence, and everything will be unchanged. And this was the scenario of the independentists. Obviously, we can see right now that it was untrue, but if you are a bit realistic politician, you can say that nothing in the world functions as ceteris paribus, as we are teaching in the first year in microeconomics. Obviously, that was absolutely a lie by the independentists, saying the people that when we get independence peacefully, legally, we will stay in the EU, everything will be unchanged, all the companies will stay here, you won't lose your job, and everything will be the same as shiny. Obviously, that was a lie. The second scenario, which is an optimistic scenario, economists were writing about already in 2014-15, mostly financed by the Generalitat, so obviously they were not really, independent in the way of academic form, and they were really independentist. And the third scenario, which I call a realistic pessimistic scenario, which we can have a touch from the last 2 months. What happens if a region tries to break away, and if this region pretends to take some steps, which is clearly unconstitutional, so in this point I agree absolutely with you. So what are in this realistic scenario, which I see as a pessimistic scenario? First, it's obviously that the European Union won't accept Catalonia as automatically as a member state. Such kind of things in the European Union, that somebody became automatically member just because their politicians are wishing for it, obviously if somebody, a lawyer, international lawyer, it sees that this absolutely not understandable thing. What does it mean if Catalonia, from the first day of its independence, hypothetical scenario, so gets out of the European Union? What does it mean for a region, for a new country, to be out of the European Union? Obviously, problems with the euro, no right to use the euro, it's no member anymore in the Schengen zone, so it will need absolutely a passport to cross the border. It will fall out of the single market, which means that every product and services it's made or produced or provided in this region cannot cross the border. Why should they? They have no contract with the EU how to cross these goods or services or people through this border. And obviously we can go on to international things like how to become a member of UN and NATO and so on. I'm not going into it. I'm rather stop a bit with short-term economic and financial effects. Obviously, if you have a look at the last 2 months, you can see absolutely clearly that most of the companies, most of them were multinational, however, with the seats in Barcelona, they was moving away just by the threat of getting out of the single market of the European Union. Obviously, they don't want to get out of the single market. So this right now 500 million people is the market for them, not the 7 million of Catalonia. And obviously they want to get seated in a region outside of the EU and jeopardizing its position in a global position by taxes and so on, what they have. So obviously these companies were fleeing, most of them. Actually the Catalan stock exchange is right now empty. Most of their companies fled Catalonia, so I really don't know how the index of the Catalan index is right now composed by one company. I think it's still left, which is a Freixenet, the champagne, Catalan champagne company. That's not enough for survival. You brought some of the
yes, notes.
I brought a Catalan champagne, but not
Freixenet. I'm sad. And obviously, when you see how changed, for example, the room reservations from the hotels and the tourism industry, from February to October, there was a real fall of nearly 5% just in 1 month, just because this kind of political instability, because Barcelona is the same, it's still beautiful, it still has nice food, there is still all the houses of Gaudi and so on. So the only thing what the people was frightened about the images for all these process, how they are calling, and the tourists are not going to the places where they don't feel secure. And from this point of view, they were losing tourism. Actually, in September, the youth organization of the same party, CUP, was punching buses, tourist buses, and saying and shouting, I'm sorry to say, fuck off tourists. That was the way how they were shouting for the tourists. So now they did actually achieve this. So a good portion of the tourists are really reconsidering whether to go there or not. And if you reconsider the composition of the GDP in Catalonia is around 15% depending on tourism and all the service industries and restaurants and so on and so forth. 15%, so you are jeopardizing this part as well. Just to mention some points from His Excellency's speech, and perhaps here I'm trying to create a kind of conflict between each other. I'm an academician, so I may. You were mentioning that obviously the media was manipulating, and the Generalitat was absolutely manipulating the media through the Facebook and through all of these things, but you cannot deny that there were police violence during this absolutely unconstitutional and illegal referendum. And some of these images were really creating sympathy for the Catalan case outside of Spain. And obviously, this is not a good news for the Spanish government, I mean long term. In short term, obviously, the Spanish government has an absolutely solid legal base, but right now the Catalans are not thinking about 2 months term. They are thinking about a long term. If you have a look what are the ERC politicians are saying from the prison, they are saying that they are absolutely abandoning the unilateral independentization movement. They still regard this as a long-term goal, but they do not want to get back the same steps as they did before, and they are asking the Supreme Court to let them out to campaign for the December election. And we will see what the Spanish court will say to these things. I absolutely agree that, and now I'm passing the floor to Zoltan, that the Catalan autonomy, what they were living in the last 30 years, was absolutely unprecedented way of autodetermination, which most of the European and non-European minorities are just dreaming about, and perhaps they will never reach. So I really have to accept that what the Catalan Catalonia had was unprecedented. It was absolutely a wide range autonomy, and this kind of independence movement is partially a hysterical creation of some politicians, Catalan separatist politicians, who are trying to cover some of their own corruption scandals, some of their own mismanaging of the of Catalonia by pointing at the central government that they are robbing us, they are robbing from our region, and so on and so forth. And just one detail, I was reading really independent academician calculating how much is the net balance of Catalonia to the Spanish budget. And based on the numbers of the years of 2000-2010, the average yearly net paying in by Catalonia was around 7% of the yearly GDP. Bavaria to Germany is around 9-10. So you can say it's too much or it's not too much. However, as Catalonia has the level of GDP as Austria and Denmark, obviously has to pay more into the central budget than an underdeveloped region like Extremadura. So just because of this is not a good reason of any region to get independence. Thank you.
Thank you, Sándor. I'm not sure whether the ambassador would like to react, or first we will give the floor to Zoltán and then we'll open it up for reactions. It's also very interesting. I've just read that although the GDP of Catalonia is very high, it's higher than the Spanish average, it's also one of the most indebted regions as far as I know. So it has a lot of debt, which is compensated by the Spanish government. I think it's also very, very interesting and raises doubt about this whole calculation. So Zoltán Kantor is the director of the Research Institute on Hunger, National Hungarian Minorities Abroad, Hungarian Communities Abroad. He is also a lecturer at Pazman Péter University. He has studied in Temesvár, Temesvára, Budapest and Edinburgh. I think he holds a PhD from CU. And he's also an author and editor of several books, including Autonomies in Europe, Solutions and Challenges, published by his institute and also Lanatan. And he has also brought a copy of this Hungarian Journal of Minority Studies that you're welcome to have a look at. Zoltán, it's a pleasure to be here.
Noemi, thank you for inviting me. It's an honor to be here at the Danube Institute. It's an honor to be at the same table with Mr. Ambassador Sándor Gyula, and to speak about these issues. And obviously, I will speak on the Hungarian perspective of this issue, as probably most of you did observe that in Hungary, but especially the Hungarians in the neighboring states, watch with a double attention what is going on in Spain. They watch also some years ago what is going on in Scotland. And what Sándor said, that it's of a special interest in this region from minority perspective. Here I have to quote or to recall what Francesco Palermo said immediately after the elections regarding the link between autonomy, secession, minority rights. He mentioned that this is not an issue of minority rights. Us Catalans in Catalonia have next to all the rights they need. Francesco Palermo, by the way, is a senator to the Parliament of Italy, sent also by the Germans from South Tyrol. He represents both the interests of the Italians and Germans in South Tyrol, and he is a very highly appreciated lawyer on minority rights. So yes, the starting point is that Catalonia was one of the models of autonomy for the minorities living here in the neighboring states. Now I will present some maps, some data, and I have here ideas. This referendum on independence has both theoretical and political implications. As Mr. Ambassador mentioned, the issue of nationalism, and scholars in this field analyze now this issue, parallelly interpreting the nationalism of the minority, the nationalism of the majority. Here in our region, we usually look at the nationalism of the minority, of the majority, and the nationalism of the king state. And here I have to mention something in a footnote. I use nationalism as a process, as a neutral concept, as a scientific concept, but this referendum and the process fosters this field of national studies. The other part, political implications on minority politics, but I would say especially on the issue of power sharing, on how to accommodate minority rights or nationality rights and the issue of stability. Now, some preliminary conclusions. What one can draw from the experiences after the referendum? One is that identity, I would say national identity matters. And it matters not only in East Central Europe, as many people think, but also in Western Europe. Obviously, one has to add my colleagues already said, that it's not only on national identity, it has to do with politics, both domestic politics and EU politics, and also with economic issue. Again, it opened the debate on the issue of autonomy and independence in relation or in the framework of international law from a EU perspective. And as we know well, that international law basically has not too much to say on independence and also not too much on autonomy. If domestic law permits, then independence can be reached, autonomy can be reached. For autonomy, we have only some recommendations that it is a good tool for accommodating minority rights. We also are witnesses of this increased interest from the part of the Hungarians living in the neighboring states, but I would say larger from the part of every minority in Europe. And what is going on in Scotland, Lombardia, Veneto, Catalonia, some years ago, what is going on in Kosovo. And as you know very well, for Hungarians, there are especially three models, South Tyrol, the Åland Isles, and Catalonia and the Basque Country, obviously, as the stage, as the goals they also would like to reach. So, as Sándor said, every Hungarian minority in the neighboring states would be absolutely satisfied with having the rights Catalans have in Catalonia. Now I will use some maps. These are the maps of Karol Kocsis, a Hungarian academician. And here he put on the map all the autonomies, existing functioning autonomies in Europe. And in the next map, we see also the potential autonomies in Europe. We see that in many countries, many minorities would like to become autonomous, looking for some solutions in this field. Now, to speak a bit on some similarities and differences between Catalans, Catalonia, and the Hungarians in the neighboring states. First, whether they have kin state. Hungarians in the neighboring states have a kin state, while Catalans, not basically. Catalans live in the autonomous region of Catalonia. Catalans have autonomy, and as I told, a large extended autonomy, while the Hungarians in neighboring states, basically, not with the exception of Serbia, where they have a cultural autonomy in Vojvodina. The goal of the Catalans is of some is autonomy and or independence for some autonomy as it is, for some a more extended autonomy and for some independence, while the Hungarians in the neighboring states, they strive for autonomy and as I will speak a bit later on this connection between autonomy and independence. Whether Catalans have and Hungarians have support, international support, the yes means here in the case of Catalonia, yes for autonomy and no for independence. Of course, we did observe basically no European state took part of the Catalans. And now if we look at the Hungarians in the neighboring state, there is no international support for autonomy, but nobody is against if the minority and the majority can make the deal, the arrangement in the particular country. And now we have just a short word on terminology for Hungarians in the neighboring states. Hungarians and especially the literature uses the concept national minority, while the official denomination for the Catalans, according to the Spanish constitution, is nationality. But scholars in this field use sometimes the stateless nation or nation as concept for the Catalans. Now, just some words on the Hungarian national minorities abroad. Hungarians are in all the seven neighboring countries, about 2.2 million Hungarians in total in the neighboring states. And we may say that about 20% of the Hungarians live as national minorities in the neighboring states. And yes, two things, that they are among the most active minorities in Europe, and Hungarians in the neighboring states have a very active kin state. Now, just on the map, the Hungarians living in the neighboring states, you see that most of them live close to the border of Hungary, and an important number, about 600,000, live in the middle of Romania, in the so-called region of sacred land, basically the region that is most active in striving for autonomy. Here are the detailed figures, but I will skip this slide. And here I just show on the map more in detail where the majority of Hungarians live, about 80% in this red Hargita County, and about 70% of the population in Kovasna County. Here a map where at least 500 Hungarians live in the neighboring states. And here an interesting map, also a map of Kocsis Károly, where he looks from a demographic perspective where autonomy would be possible. And we see that there are some regions beside the sacred land in Slovakia, Transcarpathia and Vojvodina. Obviously, this is only one aspect, the demographic perspective. We have two similarly, or maybe even more important aspects, the political and the legal, whether the political system permits autonomy arrangements according to the particular present constitution, and if it permits, whether there is a political will to offer autonomy for the minorities. National minorities strive especially for cultural, linguistic, basically national reproduction. That is, I would say, the cornerstone to understand every such movement that refers to national identity, that they would like to have this, secure this reproduction. And there is the perception, right or wrong, that autonomy solutions are the best frame to secure this. And everything else are only tools, the ethnic parties, extensions of national minority rights, autonomy, they are tools to secure this reproduction. If you have an overview on the strives toward autonomy or toward the extension of rights of the neighboring states, I would just mention some things that state-sponsored Hungarian university, taking into account demographic issues during regional reorganizations. In the Ukraine, we have many problems. Now many people have not only minorities problems, especially the issue of war. Now, minority language law, law on education. In Slovakia also the state language law, minority language law. And in Serbia, I would say, the whole issue of minority rights during the EU accession talks. And from the part of the minority, the answer is that probably the best solution would be offering territorial autonomy where it is demographically possible and cultural autonomy where not. And now let's look at the end of this short intervention that how Hungarians watched the referendum and what is going on in Spain and Catalonia. I have to emphasize that there was a sympathy toward the Catalans, but in the same time we have also to mention that it is not a path to follow, especially because it's counterproductive for their goals. Because Hungarians in the neighboring states strive especially for autonomy and not for independence, and the message is not proper for this goal. Hungary's position was that as the position of most European, or I would say all of European states, that is a domestic affair of Spain. And Hungary supports, regarding the minorities in the neighboring states, the goals formulated by the key minorities. And if we look at the neighboring states, then we observe that they were also looking to the lens of their domestic affairs. And some journalists maybe, and also some politicians mentioned that it's not good to accord autonomy for the minorities because look, the next step is independence. This is what is not positive for the Hungarians living in the neighboring states. And yes, we may continue with some questions, but questions that are not too easy to answer. Whether autonomy is the best solution for minority protection? My personal answer is yes. And the second, whether autonomy is the next step towards secession? I would say no, but we see that in some cases yes, but for sure this is not the goal of the Hungarians living in the neighboring states. Thank you for your attention and then during the debate.
Thank you, Zoltán. One of our purposes in organizing this conference was also to, that you found out during the organization, is to dispel some of the misunderstandings about Hungarian minority initiatives or efforts. And just, I'd like to ask Zoltan to say two sentences about the difference between a culture and a territorial autonomy, because this, as we found out, might cause some misunderstandings.
Yes. Both are forms of power sharing, of accommodating minority rights. Territorial autonomy basically means that all the people who live at the territory, they may democratically vote for the fate of the people who live in that particular territory. Territorial autonomy makes sense only in situations where the countrywide minority is in a majority in that particular territory, and then within the territory everybody votes democratically for the issues, but the minorities are here a bit in advantage. Personal or cultural autonomy means basically that it's not linked to territory but to the people. So people who consider themselves as members belonging to that minority, and based on a register, they decide on who should lead them and in what direction. And obviously, the competences of a personal autonomy are much more restricted as the competences of a territorial autonomy.
Thank you very much. I think first I'd like to give the floor to our speakers to react to each other. And also to share your views about, we can maybe extend our time frame.
I don't know if we can extend our time. I hope so.
Yes.
But I think we have all made our case quite nicely. I personally would very much like to see what the reaction of the public is. If they have something to say. Warning to them, not warning, because that's a nasty word, but telling them that there are not nasty or difficult questions, there are only indiscreet answers. So I would very much appreciate, after all these three talks on this subject, which refers to Spain, but refers to Europe, and refers to Hungary, what do you feel about it? What are your questions? That I would very much like. Otherwise, I have a couple of things to say.
I still think that you can say if you want, just shortly, if you want to react, you don't want to react. Zoltan, do you have any reactions to your colleagues?
I included them in my presentations.
So then I'd like to open the floor for questions. And I'd like to ask you to please introduce yourselves. Thank you.
My name is Ernő Kessei, coming from Mitosulán University, but I'm a chemist. Interested in the topic, obviously. I freshed up my memory about Norway. And I know that the difference is that in the union between Sweden and Norway, there was in the constitution the right for secession. This is a, an obvious difference here. But you told that we should ask nasty questions as well. I'm for the self-determination right of any ethnic units or any cultures. As Hungarians, due to the Finno-Ugrian relations, we have witnessed the complete eradication of some people belonging to this Finno-Ugrian group of people. So I understand the difference between the two constitutional and judicial situations. But I still feel that any ethnical groups have their right to self-determination. And I would like to have your reflection on this feeling. Thank you.
Before we engage in a discussion about this, would you be so kind as to define what is ethnic determination, on which grounds?
Well, I could also cite Quebec. I've been lived for 4 years in Quebec, and I also witnessed the pros and cons of being a federal state which has different laws than all the other federal states of Canada. And I had ambiguous feelings about it. So,
Excuse me, sir, you bring an example, but you are not defining ethnic.
Yes, I will come closer to the subject. So I consider that the rights of English speaking people, and now my definition is language, the rights of English speaking people is somehow violated in Quebec by the French majority in Quebec, which is a minority in Canada. So language is very much important. And for the history of Quebec, they could retain their culture and language due to religion. So religion is my other definition, which obviously does not work in the middle of Europe, but this is an important question. So language is the most important.
Language is the basic fundament.
Yes, and common history.
So people who come to from another country and learn the language, they immediately are assimilated to ethnic
most of the time. Issue?
Okay.
Yes.
I am sorry, but I cannot go along with that. It's perfectly, it's very legitimate that you do that. But that doesn't work like that.
But I'm going to your definition of ethnic unity.
No, but I mean, that's the problem, the definition of ethnicity. What is the ethnicity? The people who came from the eastern corner of Africa, our first forefathers, 4 or 5 million years ago, or all the rest of tribes that mixed together and came up to this? The Hungarians,
well,
are they original, or they came from Central Asia?
In my family, I have forefathers and foremothers having the name Horvat and Nemet, which means Croatian or German. So this is a Hungarian, a typical Hungarian. Oh, I guess the same situation in Spain.
Sure.
But
so you are Hungarian or Croatian?
I'm Hungarian. Once assimilated, we form the same ethnic unit.
I beg your point. We cannot go from here because it is impossible.
I'm sorry to speak too much.
No, you are not. I thank you very much for your contribution.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the Danube Institute and the amazing panel group panel for this opportunity. My name is Marco Christopher Cagliati. I work at the EUCHAM, but this is my opinion. And I'd like to continue on this point about ethical identities. I'm from Kenya, which is currently in the world news for all of this strife around the elections, which are along tribal lines who identify themselves on ethical basis of where they arrive and everything. And my question is not really about what is the definition of everything, but more how do we see, and this question is to the whole panel, what is the way forward, and not looking at a scenario of breaking off, Catalonia becoming independent, but how policy-wise and from academic specialization, seeing how would they resolve this in a sense that it's also the Catalan people giving their opinion and having a compromise around it and having a non-violent short-term and long-term solution to this current crisis, which could mean independent or autonomous or a unified country. How would that happen? And I'm asking for the opinion. Thank you.
I'm sorry to monopolize the panel. If my colleagues want to say something. But there are certain things that are at the core of the question. When you speak about the Catalan people, which Catalan people are you talking about? Yes? Because there are two kinds of Catalan peoples, those who are for and those who are against. Are we going in a country that are basically mixed to ask them to choose? That is very, very, very difficult. I cannot come up with an example that could be close to you in Hungary. But I mean, if the people in Miskolc don't feel exactly like the people in Szeged, are they entitled to take decisions that will break from each other? Because that's basically the same point. Because if we speak about the Catalan people does not exist. Even those people that are for the Catalan independence are talking that the Catalan people is the people that are living in Catalonia. And the people that are living in Catalonia, more than 60%, were not born in Catalonia. And if we come to Spain, I mean, prior to the year 2000, there were the Iberos, the Celts, then the Visigoths, the Romans, the Arabs, whatever. So who are the real Spaniards? Who are they? Who are they? Today, how come we can, I mean, according to, I don't know where you come from, but the people in the United States, they can claim the people of your ethnicity a totally different treatment, whereas they are claiming the same treatment as any US citizen or in any other country. And that is what was my point at the beginning. In Europe, we have had invasions. We have had all the time for 2,000 years, for 6,000 years. So what are we now? We are just an amount of people that through civilization have come to reach a level of rights for citizens, for fundamental rights. Well, we can respect your language, we can respect your culture, you can respect many things, but not on ethnic lines, because if it is on ethnic lines, we are going to find a solution. Sorry, I think I'm arousing people.
Sir, just I'll give you the floor. Just to clarify, I think his question related more to the political solution. Rather than that, we cannot solve this along ethnic lines, and I don't think we have to go into this this discussion because it's very emotional.
sorry,
no,
because
I think one of the valid questions is, but I will give to the floor to the colleagues as well, is in what direction this whole secessionist movement will take the case of autonomy of this of the region of Catalonia. Do you think that it will strengthen the autonomy, or it will weaken it, or at least that's how I understood the question. But first, I'd like to give the floor to Shander and Zoltan.
Okay, so as there are here some of my students, they are witnesses that we did talk about an hour only on the issue of the possible definitions of the nation. I will not repeat this class here, but I just would like to mention that there is no universal definition, universally accepted definition of ethnicity of the nation, etc. There are sociological definitions, legal definitions based on political will, and what really matters is who has the power to define the national minority. Similarly, the issue is on who has the power to define who has the right to self-determination, who belongs to that group or which is the territory. And we see that in practice, they did find an agreement, and yes, referendum in Scotland, everybody who lives in Scotland over 16 years, and also the guest worker or people who live there who are not EU citizens, had also, or British citizen, had the right to participate in the election. It depends on the power, who has who can decide this. And in line with this, with the other question, the solution. See, the question is on a political solution. As a scientist, I would say that science absolutely has nothing to say in this issue. Science is not, has not the competence to say something. We may analyze the political processes and the solution. Probably the leftist Spanish political parties have one solution, rightists have another. Leftist Catalans and rightist Catalans and pro-independence and against have different solutions. EU has solution. A lot of politicians or political actors have solution. But I don't think that scientifically or methodologically there is one solution. Because we may now wait. What is more important? Issue of identity? Issue of stability? Issue of economics. If we tell the perspective and our values, then we may give an answer, but in this way we may give at least 100 types of answers. So I would say science cannot tell in this. We can take positions.
As a way out, as a maximum, I can give you wishful thinking. What I think would be a nice way out, but the problem is that normally the people are deciding and they are sometimes voting things like you could not imagine, quoting Brexit. What right now the Catalan society is showing more or less is that they are absolutely nicely divided. 45% independentist, 45% unionist, obviously split by left, by right wing, and so on. And there is 10% which is the party called Podemos, which they are doing this. Yes, we are for autodetermination. But they are not saying anything publicly about whether they want to be independent or no. Which means that if right now the public polls would turn into the results of the December election, it seems that Catalonia will be ungovernmentable. Nice, really. So, way out, really I don't know what will be the way out. Somebody has to turn a bit, somebody has to give up something. Obviously, it seems right now that some of the independentists are giving up something, at least a unilateral way of independization. However, they are still for independence, but not right now and right here by violence or whatever. So this step back could give a possibility for forming a kind of government which perhaps may function. But if you have seen, there will be some very similar deadlock in Spanish national elections 2 years ago, and they had to repeat the elections, which means that actually it's not impossible that in Catalonia after the December election it will come a spring election again. As from scientific way we cannot give you a right answer, from a political analyst way I cannot give you a right answer. Sorry, this is the day of no answers.
I'd like to ask everybody to please keep your questions short.
My question is short, but my introduction is long. My name is Jean Roquerich. And the first half of my preface is that I lived through the Quebec referendums, both of them. I lived through the Quebec referendums, both of them. And my other preface is that, thanks to a fortuitous invitation, I have made my first visit to Spain in September. And really? In Catalonia, into Barcelona, yes. I traveled around Catalonia and I spent a week and a half or so in Barcelona as well. I was there on that National Day demonstration. I made a video of it. So, I have a little bit of experience. Wouldn't be an expert by any means, but I was there. And I saw that the yes had an unbelievable amount of advertising and propaganda, and the no had none.
Excuse me?
The no had no propaganda.
The no no vote, no, and no promotion. Nobody supported publicly the no vote.
Yes.
The government of Spain abandoned the no, did not campaign against the referendum. That was one mistake the government made. And you, sir, said that your constitution is similar to those constitutions of similar states. Well, sir, your choice to compare your constitution to similar ones, but in fact, some federal states' constitutions allow for secessions if it is justified. So it is a highly, not highly, it's a slightly tendentious choice of comparison. And the other thing you said, sir, that there was no validity to the referendum. So if that is the case, why was so heavy-handed the action of the federal government? Why did they add fuel to the fire? Why were they so clumsy to make the crisis deeper instead of lightening it up?
That's the question.
And
I have other people
who want to
ask
questions.
We can talk later. I would be glad to talk to you later.
Can you, shall we collect the questions and then?
Sure.
I think just for, please try to remember your answers.
I would want to thank you for the Danube Institute for organizing the event as well. My name is Ata Chola, a student currently. I have a question for all the lecturers. The recent public service showed that only 24% of the voters would support completely the independence. However, the political parties that support the independence and those who do not, the share between them are equal, as Shandula said as well. With an expanded in the Catalan history record-breaking attendance, 80%, we can see that the Catalonian nation is divided completely. So my question is that, is it a possibility that if the election would not give a wished result for both parties, the events could escalate and perhaps turn into terrorist attempts or eventually establishment of a terrorist group similar to ETA in Basque? Is it a possibility or hopefully it is not? That's the question. And the second question is to Mr. Ambassador. In your speech, you stated, if I heard you correctly, that there were no police force used in the referendum. Despite the official opinion of the government, despite the fact that reportedly 600 to 800 people at least received injuries, there are hundreds of videos and official hospital therapies as well. So there are many.
Nick Thorpe, I'm the regional correspondent for the BBC. I would have one very short question for Mr. Cantor. You said the Catalonian developments are problematic for Hungarian minorities. Surely they're, to put it bluntly, a total disaster for any attempts at autonomy for Hungarian minorities. As you said, this Catalonia has always been a sort of shining example for Hungarian minorities. How can they ask for autonomy after this?
So no other questions? There's one more? No. Okay, so we've collected the questions, and I'd like to ask our speakers to take turns and answer. Mr. Repasta?
Okay, I am not sure that I can remember exactly the thrust of your question, but I'm ready to talk to you in a few minutes. There was something that you said about how many constitutions contemplate the right of secession. Please tell me how many of them. Perhaps one or two in the whole world, Ethiopia and another one. All the others do not contemplate that right of secession. That's the case, Mr. And the rest of what you said, I'm ready to discuss with you, because right now I cannot go over this. I don't remember where, what the other colleague said about ETA, but the police force use. I mean, there was use of police force on the 1st of October, yes, and we are very sorry. We are very sorry. And it was a mistake. It should haven't taken place. But it has been presented in a way in which it was not. The police was not sent by the government against the voters. And it has to be understood. And otherwise, if we don't understand that, we are just missing the point. The police went to fulfill a duty ordered by a judge, and the police was harassed by the people, and they were secluded, and they had to fight their way out. And the day after, all the images, more than half, were fake news and were images from previous confrontations of the police, of which many of them were confrontation of the autonomous police, not of the national police. So if we just make a general statement about the police under the government orders fighting the normal, beautiful Catalan voters that wanted to vote, and they went, that is just not true. You may accept it or you may not accept it, but that is one of the problems of our world. A world of Twitter, of Facebook, of fake news, or whatever. It just was not, and it is being investigated. And many, many reasonable and serious media in the world, like Le Monde and Financial Times, have denounced that most of those news were fake. So we can keep on talking about the police brutality, and there was, but under which circumstances? It was just a police that was sent by the government to repress poor innocent voters that wanted to express their will? No, sir, that was not the case. It was a completely different approach. That's the rest of the questions were not for me.
Okay, then I will reflect. Two questions. One, the first one was whether escalation. So personally, I don't think. But if we look at the different autonomy fighting quotation mark, we see that this went step by step. We see that sometimes there were violences, Basque Country or Northern Ireland, for example. But even in South Tyrol, not against persons, but some such things. I think. Violence will not be, but in the long run, this may be something Catalans will refer to. So I expect that there will be a long run of games. And the other question on how can ask Hungarians autonomy after this referendum? A similar question was at the table after the referendum in Scotland. Obviously, as I mentioned, that from Hungarian autonomy perspective, this is counterproductive. So Hungarians now have to work even more to convince Romanians, Slovaks, Ukrainians, Serbs that the next step will not be autonomy. So the request is. Next step will not be independent. The request is autonomy, and they will have to work much more on convincing the majorities and the larger European audience.
So it seems I will have the final remark. Nice. To Mr.
I tried.
To Mr. Kerakes, it was a very, very good question why there was no campaigning for the no. Actually, I was thinking about earlier when it was a preparation for all of the things. Sometimes I have to say that the people who were for the no, they said that by ignoring the whole process, it's a solution.
it's not, obviously. So they should have done a response, they should have had a response like in Scotland they did without legal referendum. I understand that they were judging that this is an illegal referendum. However, if you're not showing that the country loves this region, that they showing belonging together in a kind of some mass protest, as the independentists were showing that we are, do not belong together, it was a mistake, from my point of view. It was a huge mistake not doing anything before, and it's still, it's a big mistake not doing it now. They should, the Spanish government, the Spanish people as such, other political parties, everyone who thinks that Spain belongs together should do a campaign why this country belongs together. I think personally that this country belongs together, so don't misunderstand me. However, I could criticize a lot of the government's move which was made in the last 2 years regarding the Catalan question, and one of the move was silence. And this was a mistake from my point of view. For our part, I've seen the same poll, what you said, that just 24% of the people are for the process. It does not mean that they are not independentists. I mean that they are more independentist people. But the process means that they want the unilateral independence in short term. Obviously, right now, the people's mind changed that this is not a viable way of achieving their long-term goals. So what I said already, that some of the politicians of ERC are getting back and saying, okay, we do not want you to do unilateral things, so don't mix these things. It was an interesting question, and it was a bit of a journalism to showing that there is a huge fall of independentist movement in Catalonia. There isn't. There is still 45% more or less of the people for independence. And about escalation, I think that if during the Franco dictatorship there was no escalation in Catalonia, but in Basque County you could see what you could see during some of the time, I don't think that right now in a democratic constitutional Spain inside of the European Union there will be any kind of escalation. However, it does not mean that there are some crazy people, they are everywhere. Not depending of religion and skin and race, there are crazy people. Even among Catalans, there are some crazy people. And I was seeing reports that some of these crazy ones were planning to rebuild the Terra Jura, which was a kind of ETA movement for the Catalans, and never doing huge bombs and terrorism movements, but they were a terrorist movements earlier in the Catalans, which died out. And some of the this CUP, anarchist, anti-capitalist party, they are some of the people, some of the members were thinking about to reshape this, but I don't, that they, but is a very good thing in Catalonia. They are no violence, I mean that the people normally in the last 40 years at least, they were not attacking the police. Of course, they were in October there was an incident in front of the Generalidad when the people were really burning cars and punching the cars and so on. So it was not a nice day for anyone, but expect of this, there is no violent movement in Catalonia from my point.
Before closing, I have one more very short topic. Besides Venezuela, I think it was South Ossetia, South Ossetia that stood up for the independent Catalonia, which is not a good sign for any new country. But speaking of this and hearing the question about fake news and your comments, I also heard that your defense minister cited the probability of Russian influence, of Russian propaganda influence. Are there any investigations going on? Just if you can answer in a sentence or two, please.
Yes.
And it is very clear. There is an investigation going on, and there are certain facts that are facts. There has been an interference and some meddling on the process from Russia, which is not the same to say, and that my government has not said, from the Russian government. We haven't gone that far. But all the technical data show that there has been a meddling of robots or web pages based in Russia and in the Venezuela of Hugo Chavez. Yeah, they are very close to each other. So we officially do not state anything against the Russian government. But from the real geographical part of Russia, there is an activity on this. And that is quite clear. And the investigation is going on. The investigation is going on. I don't know where it will lead us. How far will it show to be truth or not, but that's a fact. And I'm not revealing any secret of state. This has been known in all of Europe for a long time, in other countries, in other places. So when it comes to Russia today, Sputnik and all that, they are behind this sort of news that are creating problems. Is this to say that the Russian government has a policy behind it in order to pervert? No, it isn't. We don't say that. I mean, it rains, yes. Who causes the rain? That's a different question. It is raining.
And that would give us talking matters for about 2 other conferences or 10. And I don't want to open this topic. I would like to thank you all. It has been very interesting, and I think it's been a very lively debate. So I thank the audience as well for participating so actively. And on a lighter note, I would especially thank the ambassador for providing us with some Spanish Castilian red wine and Catalan champagne. There is only just a,
very important.
Yes, just there's a sip for everyone. The rest is Hungarian wine. So thank you very much. And if you don't see each other, have a nice holiday season. Merry Christmas.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.